The topic for today's discussion is Drug and Cosmetic Act Gazette, which was published on 11th of March 2020, popularly known as GSR 166E, and how to go ahead while applying for new product or procedures. So this topic is basically a continuation of Dr. Aikaj's lecture, which happened a few months back. So what we saw that he has beautifully discuss as to how we are supposed to go ahead with while applying for a new license or a renewal of a license. But many people had doubt as to how they are supposed to go ahead for applying for the products which are actually introduced in this the current gazette, in the 2020 gazette. Like, how do we go ahead for PBAC stem cells or therapeutic apheresis? Will the central licensing agency give us a license for it? So what has happened a few months back, we got an license for it. So I'm sharing a first-hand experience as to how to go ahead with these products, applying for these products. So the outline is I'll be discussing the history of Drug and Cosmetic Act, the gazettes, the amendments which are being done over the period of time. I'll be discussing the difference between the legal regulatory issues which are there in Indian blood transfusion services as compared to the peers like US FDA or UK blood transfusion services. Then we'll be discussing the Drug and Cosmetic Gazette, March 2020. It's outlined the changes which are there in 122G, then section 3 of Schedule F 12B, the changes which are there in blood and blood components, apheresis, and points to keep in mind while applying for new license, and the take home message. So the Drug and Cosmetic Act, which it actually got officially published in 1945. What has happened in 1937, a bill was introduced in Central Legislative Assembly to give recommendations of Drug Enquiry Committee to regulate imports of drug in India. So Drug and Cosmetic Act was passed by Central Legislative Assembly on 10th of April 1940, and it got published, became an act. So why is Drug and Cosmetic Act based? Suppose if you see, it's drug and cosmetic, whereas we are concerned about blood. So why is Drug and Cosmetic Act important for us? The reason is human blood is considered a drug. Is considered drug according to Indian Pharmacopoeia, which requires a manufacturing license under Section 3B of Drug and Cosmetic Act 1940 because it is being administered internally to a patient. Now, this Drug and Cosmetic Act and rules provide legal framework for regulating functions of blood banks, which in turn directly determine the quality of blood transfusion services in country. Now, this was the blood banking, the blood transfusion services were actually introduced in the Drug and Cosmetic Act in 1960. Although the initial, it was published in 1945, but the blood transfusion services legal requirement came in 1960. So after 1960, the blood banking services got introduced. There was a first amendment in 1993. So what were the major amendments in this in the first amendments? So they mandated blood banks to have a license in order to run the same in India. So as you know, and even Dr. Aikaj has discussed that actually health is a state subject. So what had happened, even drugs will be acting as a state subject, but they have established a dual licensing system. So whenever we have a renewal or we apply for a new license, centers will come and do an audit. And that is the dual in the first amendment in 1993, they give a right to give a license to annotated with the power of Central Licensing Approving Authority to approve license of blood and blood products, fluids or vaccines and sera. So before the before 98, even professional donors were allowed. So Drug Control General of India banned professional donors in 1998. in order to do so, and second amendment in 1999 came, which actually gave an insight as to how the blood transfusion blood bank should function. Like it gave an accommodation requirement, the staff requirements, the requirements as to eligibility for medical staff, whether what sort of qualification do they require, the equipment requirements, the labeling requirements, and they even gave an permission to conduct blood donation camps to regional blood transfusion services, RBTCs or government recognized blood banks, but not to private hospitals blood bank. So the third amendment came in 2001, which mandated HCV to be compulsory. And what they wanted, they saw that the number of blood banks were on a higher side and their collections were low. So they started the concept of blood storage center. Whereas suppose if the collection is less than 2000, then those sorts of blood center will blood banks should be converted to a storage center where they will not be able to collect the blood bank blood from a donor, but they can actually issue blood to their center. And the license is the permission was exempted for FRUs, CSC and PHCs. In 2002, government adopted a national blood policy and its action plan in 2003, which actually had 8 objectives. The objectives are mainly focused on as to improving the blood transfusion services in India, how to go ahead while for promoting voluntary blood and all. In 2018, we all know we got the permission for conducting blood donation camps, the private blood banks got permission for conducting blood donation camps, and the latest amendment is of the 11th March 2020 amendment, which we'll be discussing in further slides. So what we can see over the period of 1960s to 2020, around 6 or 7 major amendments have happened. So if we consider an average of amendments, one amendment in around 5 to 10 years, that is quite a long time. So why is this happening? Suppose if we compare it with the peers like UK or blood transfusion services, which are there available in, which are there in USA, what happens is blood transfusion services are in India are actually included in a Drug and Cosmetic Act, and they consider blood as a drug. Whereas US or UK consider blood as a biologic, which is regulated by an independent. Or a specialized authority, for example, for biologics evaluation and research, which is a sub-arm of US, happening in the Drug and Cosmetic Act in Indian scenario, what happens is they need to pass through a parliamentary proceeding. So we all know how government works, and hence the amendments which are there take a long time as compared to the US or UK blood transfusion services, where the advisory committee is already there. That for example, CBR is there in USA. They give that advices to the blood. They give an advices on a regular basis, and that becomes an act, because in USA there is a code of federal regulation which is there in their law. They have simply gave a sentence over there that whatever advisory committee from CBR which is there, the amendments which are published in their advisory committee will become the law for blood transfusion services in that country. The other major concern when we include blood transfusion services in Drug and Cosmetic Act is that any drug which needs an approval for being getting administered to a patient, it needs a pharmacopeial reference. We all know Indian pharmacopoeia has a limited reference for additional products which are being there in which have been added over a period of time in India. Whereas in US, the guidelines are provided by a specific body and they get amendment in the act. So what happens in this, suppose, is the, yeah, hello. So suppose in India, if we need to add a cryodeficient plasma or PF24 kind of product in our scopes of services, we will have to provide an reference, pharmacopoeial reference for these kind of products. If we see in US or UK, the pharmacopoeial references are not there in USP or BP. what happens is we are not able to provide specific reference, a pharmacopeial reference, in order to get an approval for these kind of products. And that is where we are lacking right now. So before 2020 amendments, the blood transfusion services are only issuing blood and blood components. It was not allowed to provide therapeutic apheresis services, nor hematopoietic stem cell services. Thanks to the 2020 amendments, at least we can now go ahead with providing therapeutic apheresis services or stem cell apheresis services via blood transfusion services. So coming to the Drug and Cosmetic Act Gazette, it was published on 11th of March 2020. It is popularly known as GSR 166E, and it relates to amendments related to blood transfusion services and Drug and Cosmetic Acts. So there are three or four major sections in these amendments, which covers the changes in the blood transfusion services. That is section 122E and G, then Schedule F, Part 12B, Schedule H, Part 12B, then Section 3 of Part 12B. So as of donor selection criteria is concerned, we all know that Drug and Cosmetic Act is basically an act. So any change, which is any sentence which is being written in that act, is basically a law. We cannot change that. Like suppose they have made an amendment that for female donors, there should be a deferral of 4 months. So it is a law. We can't change that. And I won't be discussing much about the donor selection criteria, because the discussion will be quite long. Suppose if we consider this, we'll be discussing the other amendments which are there in DNC Act. So the first thing which they have made changes is they have changed blood bank to blood center. Now, personally speaking, suppose if they have changed the name to blood bank to blood center, at least what the thing is, they should have increased the scopes of services of the blood center. In this section, they have actually defined blood center as an authorized premises in an organization or institution or case may be, for carrying out all or any of the operation, including collection, apheresis, processing, storage, and distribution of blood drawn from donors or received from another licensed blood center, and for preparation, storage, and distribution of blood. They have not mentioned anything about therapeutic apheresis or stem cell apheresis in this section. So up till now, even though Drug and Cosmetic Act have made an amendment, but there are some gray areas which we might face problems with. They have revised the medical officer experiences as compared to the previous amendments. The major thing is they have made 3 months compulsory medical experience for pathologists. Initially, there was no experience required for MD path. And for if a doctor is having an MD transfusion, he won't be needing an additional experience as compared to the other the experience like MBBS or MD path or diploma in transfusion medicine or pathology. Coming to the part 12B, that is accommodation, staff, and MSW requirements. As of now, no major changes in accommodation for apheresis has been made, but they have started giving permission for stem cell apheresis, therapeutic leukapheresis, therapeutic plasmapheresis, and cytapheresis, but no major amendments have been done as to space requirement for these kind of procedures. So the counseling room is now mandatory for donor counseling, so we need to add that in our plan. And have given guidelines for accepting technicians or technical supervisor as per their experience and degree. So what had happened ki initially, in past few years, there have been multiple degrees which are, there are some technicians who are getting degrees which are specifically related to the transfusion medicine, that is BSc in transfusion medicine or something like that. So the amendment has approved them based on their experience. The minimum experience is around 6 months for these kind of technical staff, and for diploma in this transfusion medicine, or it may be increased to around 1 year. For PGDMLT is around 1 year. They have mandated MSW, medical social worker, for all blood transfusion services, and they have even given a qualification for social worker in this gazette. So we can refer to the gazette as to there are three class of social worker which we can select. One is the 10 plus 2 with 3 years of experience, or BSc in health science with 1 year of experience, or social work degree in sociology with around three months or 6 months of experience. So if BTS is conducting a blood donation camp, they have specifically told that at least 2 medical social workers should be there as a full-time or part-time for conducting blood donation camps. So this might be an issue for multiple private hospital blood centers who usually were not having social workers as the routine technical staff. As this gadget is concerned, we need to allocate 2 medical social workers for conducting blood donation camps. Coming to the main topic, that is processing of blood components. So in the gadget, they have defined what is packed red blood cells. So the product shall be known as packed red blood cell, that is packed red blood cell remaining after separating plasma from human blood, which also includes modified packed red cells, including semi-packed red cells, washed red cells, leukoreduced red cells, irradiated red cells, and frozen red cells. So suppose if you see the sentence, what happens is packed red cells, most of the blood centers are having a license. And what we think that even leukoreduced red cells are basically part of packed red cells. But that is not the thing if you are applying for a license. The central licensing agency specifically consider each process or each sub-product as an independent product. So we need to apply for an independent product like saline wash red cells, leukodepleted red cells as an independent additional product while applying for a license. Even irradiated frozen red cells, we need to give a specific SOP. Even labeling requirements and all should be specifically related to this specific sub-process or a product. They have included types of platelets in this. As a blanket thing, platelet-rich plasma is which is rich in platelet and separated from whole blood. We took a risk at our center. We gave an SOP for platelet-rich plasma, which is being collected in ACD tubes, which are there and being used for dermatologic cases or orthopedic cases. And we got an approval for it. But you need to specifically write an SOP, the quality control criteria, then the sterility criteria and all those things needs to be mentioned while submitting it to the authorities. The gadget has told random donor platelet, which can be prepared from platelet-rich plasma and buffy coat plasma from buffy coat. So both the concern, both the terms are basically related to random donor platelets. They have even included pooled platelets. Now pooled platelets are basically pooled 6 units of random donor platelets, preferably ABO or RH match, and pooled into 1 bag of pooled platelets. So we all know as to there are different methods of pooling platelets. Means we can directly pool prepared platelets from PRP or buffy coat and then pool it and then give it to a patient using a sterile connecting device. We can pool it and then give it to a patient, or we can collect, we can mix buffy coats, 6 buffy coats, and then centrifuge it and remove the this, filter it, and then give it to a patient. So both the process, suppose if you need to apply for a license, you need to apply for a different, you need to submit an independent SOP, these kind of processes, and the quality control requirement is more than 2 into 10 to power 11. Third, the main thing is, suppose if you are applying, if you are pooling platelets via an open source, means not through a sterile connecting device, then you might not get a license if you are applying through an, if it's being prepared via an open method. The major amendments which is being done is also there in apheresis. So they have included multiple types of products in apheresis, that is plasma apheresis, platelet apheresis for harvesting platelet concentrate, that is single donor platelets, then leukapheresis for harvesting granulocyte concentrates, lymphocytes, mononuclear cells, erythrocyte apheresis, and hematopoietic stem cells via peripheral blood stem cells. So we all know that during COVID time, most of the blood centers might have applied for a plasma apheresis license, and they would have received plasma apheresis license. The main important thing is applying for a leukapheresis or an hematopoietic stem cells. So what the thing is, they are insisting on the center to be an hospital attached blood center. That is one of the major concerns which they are concerned with. they will probably not give a license to a standalone center, which is not having a dedicated BMT unit facility. Third, they will be asking as to whether they have an BMT facility in that center. They will be giving license to only those kind of centers who will be having a license, who will be having a BMT unit in their hospital. We applied for leukapheresis as well as hematopoietic stem cell as an independent product. So for leukapheresis, we told them that it's mononuclear cells which we'll be collecting, and these are unmodified leukapheresis product, mononuclear cells. But suppose if we are doing a cryopreservation, we applied for a hematopoietic stem cell, and we had submitted a cryopreservation protocol for getting a license for hematopoietic stem cells, because in hematopoietic stem cells, they have told leukapheresis section, this procedure includes hematopoietic stem cell for treatment of traditional concern, where we applied for two independent license, that is for leukapheresis as well as hematopoietic stem cell. We got a license for leukapheresis as well as hematopoietic stem cell, where hematopoietic stem cells is basically for cryopreserving the stem cells via using DMSO. So when we applied for this license, we submitted all the SOPs for this, but the drug inspector insisted on the sterility protocol which will be getting followed while doing these procedures. So all the SOPs needs to be related to the sterility and all those things needs to be mentioned while submitting the SOPs for these kind of products. And even after getting an approval from state licensing authority as well as CDSCO, the central licensing authority, that is BCGI, might reject the application based on their findings. So what I have heard, they have been around 50 applications which have already been rejected by BCGI, but not by state or the zonal licensing agency. It was specifically rejected by the Drug Control General of India. The major concern might be they are looking for a center who are actually having a bone marrow transplant unit in their centers. We even applied for therapeutic plasmapheresis and cytopheresis, and we got a license for it. We actually submitted the SOPs as to how to conduct the therapeutic apheresis in blood center. So we gave the guidelines, ASPA guidelines. We submitted the ASPA guidelines. We gave the requirements, the technical requirements, as well as the nursing requirements which are there. We gave the code blue SOPs as to suppose if there is a crash in the blood center, how we'll be managing those patients. So all these SOPs were actually given to the while applying for the therapeutic plasmapheresis and cytopheresis license. And thankfully we got it. The major thing is, even for these kind of licenses, they are looking for in-house centers. The standalone centers might not get a license for conducting therapeutic apheresis. One more thing is, suppose if the center is having a single apheresis machine and shifting that apheresis machine from ward to blood center and vice versa is not allowed by them as compared to the normal thing. What they are saying, they will be the calibration and all those things might get disturbed, and hence they took an undertaking from us that the machine which is being dedicated for blood center will only be used for this, and they are not at all concerned about doing therapeutic apheresis in wards. So suppose if any blood center is doing a therapeutic apheresis in ward, they are not at all concerned about it, provided that the machine which is being used in wards should not be used in blood center and vice versa. So important points while applying for new product as per gazette amendment is, apply for additional product permission and not a new license for existing blood centers. The name of the product should match exactly with that of the new reference. Each sub process is basically a product for central licensing agency. As such, no additional guidelines have been provided for additional infrastructure requirement for these kind of additional products, and all relevant documents like SOP, product labels, QC criteria with their validation method needs to be submitted along with the application. And TP in ICU or ward is out of scope for Drug and Cosmetic Act. So what is the taking home message? Blood transfusion services in India are regulated by DNC Act and considered blood the drug. The latest amendment of March 2020 has increased the scope of services of blood transfusion services, and each sub-process needs a valid license for the products and services which blood transfusion services can carry out. Hopefully, I think, suppose if the NBTC, if there is an amendment in the Drug and Cosmetic Act that the specialized advisory body like NBTC, whatever the amendments which are being given by the NBTC or recommendation being given by the NBTC should become law as per the Drug and Cosmetic Act, that will actually improve the scopes of services of blood transfusion services in India. Thank you. So I'll be happy to take the questions.
Thank you so much, Dr. Lalit, for such an informative and elaborative talk. Before going into the discussion phase and taking the questions, I just want to remind all our participants that we will be having a final round of our quiz on 22nd of December. So here's the list of all those winners who have won the preliminary rounds and will be participating in the final round. The winners of the first round were Dr. Vikrant Sharma. He's JR2 from AIIMS Bhopal, MP. And Dr. Tamil Priya Loganathan. She's JR2 from Mahatma Gandhi Memorial College, Indore. The winners of the second preliminary rounds were Dr. Sujay Bhomek. He's third year resident from AFMC Pune. And Dr. Shunmukh Priya. She's second year resident from TMC Tamil Nadu. The winners of the third preliminary round were Dr. G. Saranya, first year resident from GR Hospital and Medical College, and Dr. Dilna, second year resident from AFMC Pune. And the final preliminary round winners were Dr. Arun and Dr. Deepak Kumar. So I congratulate all the winners, and we want to see you doing well on the final rounds. So best wishes to all the winners, and individual emails will be sent to all the preliminary rounds winners regarding the details of the quiz and the login and everything, all procedures. If you have any questions or any doubt regarding the quiz finale on 22nd, you can post us your queries on ypf.istm@gmail.com. So coming back to the today's session, I cannot thank Dr. Lalit enough for his for sharing his experience and his work he did in taking these licenses. I like to first take question. There is one question from one of the participants, Dr. Devapriya Basu. She wants to ask you, sir, do you have the license for allogenic PRP application? I think she wants to ask for the DERMAT purpose, something like that.
So it was basically discussed, the allogenic PRP, platelet-rich plasma, which is being under our license. It's for dermatological conditions, for hair PRP or for orthopedic conditions. So we had submitted the application, the SOP based on those, and we got a license for it.
Thank you. I hope Dr. Devapriya and Dr. Lalit have answered your query. Coming back to our chairpersons, I'd like to invite Dr. Bharat Singh, sir. First, sincere apologies for the technical issues we had with you in the beginning. So would you like to share your experience regarding the licensing process, since you have been working for so long and you have been one of the leading person in the Delhi NCR region for the blood banks and all. So I'd like to hear from you regarding your experience and what you have to say about today's talk of Dr. Lalit, sir. Please.
Thank you, Saranya, for inviting me for today's webinar. So it was a nice talk by Dr. Dhantole, and he has covered almost all the points which are related to the licensing. But the recently, as the new amendment has come, the new product has come. Probably some of the blood bank which has licensed earlier, they have to apply again, either in the renewal or they can apply for the new product. So they have to apply in the format which is given by them. They have to submit the fees and submit to the state and the central zonal licensing authorities. And they will have a round of inspection with the expert along with the your SOPs, and they will see the quality control you are following. And ultimately, after the due consideration, they will give the license. But it takes time because you have to, state has to send application to the central, then they assign the team. again there will be inspection. You have to comply. If there is non compliance, again submit the compliance, and it takes about 3 to 4 months to get a new license. But the government is thinking that to make it a license on online, probably the time delay will be less, and hopefully in another next 6 months we might have licensing of blood bank and blood products for the online. And it was a nice talk. Thank you very much, Saranya. Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for taking up your precious time today. Before going to Dr. Kamini, ma'am, I'd like to take one more question from Dr. Rizwan Javed. He wants to ask Dr. Lalit, does PBSC collection and cryopreservation for therapeutic purpose done outside the blood bank require a license?
So frankly speaking, suppose if you are doing anything in the blood center premises, you need a license for it. Whatever is being done outside, it's out of purview of Drug and Cosmetic Act. We all know that many centers, harvesting and cryopreservation was even being carried out before March 2020, right? So that's the way how it was being done.
Sir, actually, most of the clinicians, they are doing this on the purview of the patient care treatment. Yes. And for that it is not required, licensing is not required. But if you have to do in a blood bank for the processing and issuing component to the other recipient, then you need the licensing. And probably the people, the clinicians, they are doing in the interest of the patient care. And that's why they are exempted for the licensing. But ideally, it should be in the blood bank, and then products should be submitted to the different users. We should think about that.
Sir, even like PBSC collection and harvesting, there are new ICMR guidelines which are being published in 2021. So as per their recommendation, it needs to be done via blood center. And as it's being amendment, the amendment is being done. Why not apply for a license? They are giving a license for a valid center.
Yes, it should be done through blood bank. Yes. I agree.
I hope this answers your queries, Dr. Javed. So now I'll move to Dr. Kamini, ma'am. Her expert's comment about sharing her own experience in this field and about today's talk. Kamini, ma'am, if you could just share your experience, ma'am.
Yeah. Thank you very much, first of all, Dr. Ekaj and Dr. Pranam for this opportunity. Just a second bit. And sir, Dr. Bharat Singh, legendary Dr. Bharat Singh with us, and thank you for being a co-chair with us, with me. And I would basically say that Dr. Zantole, you have given a very, very nice overview of the whole amendment part of this particular thing which has come up. Because I also went through this licensing renewal thing recently. And again, incorporating these things, when we already have a stationery lying up previously and you have to print new stationery, so you have to ask the same person to that you okay help us without that. But still important is that these donor selection criteria are so extensive now, and they're so good that they must be incorporated, and that's very good. Apart from this, the granulocytopheresis, the leukapheresis, which they have done as part of the amendment, has given us free hands. It has given us the power to do these things in the blood bank, and hence we can use this for the betterment of the patient without any hesitation, which we previously used to face. But of course, the quality control parameters, apart from the SOPs, must be taken care of whenever you are actually going in for these products. Because we think that, okay, SOP has been prepared and the part is done. It's not like that. When you are giving to the patient, whenever you're preparing the SOP, take part of that quality control of the product as well into it. And then only pursue further it with the product. So that's what I would like to say. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for your kind words. So we have one more question. If any of the chairpersons would like to take it, Dr. Bharat sir or Kamini, ma'am. We have a question from Dr. Mohammad Anas Sheikh. He wants to ask, any alteration in the donor selection criteria pertaining to hypothyroidism in the new amendments of 2020?
Okay. Sir.
No, at the moment, we can't do any alteration unless it is the objection can be forwarded to drug control department. It will be discussed there in the special committee, and it only after approval of this, we can have this. otherwise we can't change.
So they have actually made euthyroid condition to be acceptable. That is something which is, earlier, suddenly with NABH coming, we were thinking, okay, now that hyperthyroidism is not acceptable. But with this drug amendment, they have said that if it is euthyroid condition with the medication, then we still can take Ketone. So that is a good thing about the whole thing.
Yes.
Any other further change, sir will know better.
Yes, so I guess Dr. Mohanad, yes, if the person is hypothyroid, he's on medication and he's taking it for his dose is not changed for a duration of 28 days or more, then he can be accepted for the duration. Yes, you can take him for the duration. We have one more question from Dr. Nidhi Sharma. While applying for new products, do we need to send application to the central authority or states will suffice? Dr. Lalit, sir.
I didn't get the means with suffice. I don't understand the meaning of that.
Dr. Nidhi, if you want to take up your question.
Yeah, I meant to say that while applying for a new license, then we need to send one application to center and then another one to state. So for applying for new products, again, we need to send a separate application to center, or just if we are giving it to
it's
state.
Joint inspection.
Yes, you have to send to center and the state along with the additional fees.
So it's the same procedure like you do for the license. It's you have to do everything again from the scratch.